Hola, mis estimados amigos. En días pasados tuve la oportunidad de conversar con quien ha sido mi mentor, mi maestro, la persona que le ha aprendido más en el mundo de las opciones. Se trata de Tom Sosnoff. Tom Sosnoff fue el fundador de la plataforma Thinkorswim en 1999 y que fue posteriormente vendida en el 2009 a TD Ameritrade por una transacción superior a los 750 millones de dólares. Tom ha dedicado su vida al mundo de las opciones. Trabajó como market maker en la bolsa de opciones de Chicago, en el Chicago Board Options Exchange. ¿Y quién mejor que él para darte unas opiniones muy certeras de lo que significa el mundo de las opciones? Así que si quieres aprender verdaderamente de opciones, vale la pena que le des una mirada a esta entrevista que tuve la oportunidad de hacerle, invitado aquí al canal Opción Sigma, porque les habló a ustedes, a los amigos de la comunidad hispanohablante, insisto, para que aprendan del mejor. Si eres nuevo por acá y te gustaría seguir recibiendo este tipo de información, donde tendremos más invitados como Tom, fuentes confiables de información para que aprendas siempre de los mejores, te invito a que te suscribas al canal. Y además, si te ha gustado esta información, te invito a que le des like. Esta es la versión ya con los subtítulos en español, así que bienvenidos, no se muevan porque yo sé que les va a ayudar muchísimo en su proceso de trading. Un saludo.
I'm good. How are you? Awesome. Can't wait.
All right. Let me.
Oh, bienvenidos todos a esta transmisión aquí a través de nuestro canal Opción Sigma. Es un placer para mí y es un gran honor presentar a quien ha sido mi mentor y mi maestro, Tom Sosnoff. Vamos a hablar ya un poco con él. Tom, will you excuse me for a minute? I'm going to address to the community in Spanish and present yourself in just a minute. Así que, bueno, desde sus casas podemos darle un fuerte aplauso a Tom, que se vean los likes. Y bienvenido, Tom. Bienvenido a este tu canal, Opción Sigma. Así que, bueno, aquí lo tenemos. Tom Sosnoff, welcome, Tom, to Opción Sigma. It's such a great honor being you're here with us. So thank you for the opportunity to share some thoughts and some knowledge on all your experience you have during these years working as a trader and working as in the CBO, in the CBOE in the past. Welcome, Tom.
Thanks so much. I'm happy to be here. Appreciate the opportunity.
No, thank you for coming. Quick disclaimer before we start. Y lo voy a decir en español, y es que la información que contiene este canal, Opción Sigma, es para fines educativos, para fines informativos generales. Así que solamente les pido que si ustedes tienen algún tipo de, requieren algún tipo de asesoría legal o financiera, por favor acudan a los profesionales correspondientes. El día de hoy tenemos como nuestro invitado Tom Sosnoff y quizás vamos a hablar de algunas estrategias, pero que de ninguna manera son una recomendación por parte ni de Luis Sigma y Sigma Option LLC, ni una solicitud para que hagan estas estrategias. Así que, bueno, esta va a ser la agenda que vamos a cubrir el día de hoy. Una pequeña introducción, la historia, and I would like to ask you, Tom, who is Tom? So I heard that you work as a market maker, but how come a person with your background, because I know you study political science, ended up working in the financial industry?
Because when I graduated college, when I graduated from the university, there were no jobs. Well, I shouldn't say there were no jobs. It was the middle of a recession. And the first interview I got was in the financial space and they offered me a job, so I took it.
All right.
And I never left.
So you pretended to become like a politician or something?
No. I thought I was gonna study, I thought I, when I was in school, I was studying I was studying political science, but I was interning. I interned in the House of Commons. I interned in the state government, and I thought I was going to be in some kind of a lobbyist slash, you know, some kind of a political role. But when I got out of school, my first job offer came in the world of finance, so I just stayed there forever.
All right. So you work as a market maker in the Chicago Board Options Exchange. Tell us a little bit about it. So what is the role of the market maker?
Well, back when I started, which was in the early 80s, the market makers were those crazy, you've seen pictures and scenes where there's a bunch of guys standing in a pit yelling and screaming. That was what I did. That's a market maker. And the market making business, essentially, you know, if you were trying to be politically correct, you would say we would be providing liquidity to the marketplace. You know, we're making markets. You want to sell something, I'll buy it from you. You want to buy something, I'll sell it to you. Basically, we're the other side, the counterparty to anything you want to do.
Okay. Options were born in 1973, as far as I know. 1973, where the
1974, I think, but it could have been 73. I'm not sure.
73, the calls, and 77, the puts showed up. But you were there on the go. So
no, I was there from 1980, 81.
Okay, and you stayed there for 20 years, I hear?
20 years. 20. I traded the S&P 100, yes.
You traded the S&P 100. What makes you like follow the step to start your own company, like Thinkorswim at that time? So what was your impulse to do that?
Well, okay, so Lewis, let's think about pit trading for a second. Just I'll tell you what it was like. So every day you go to work on this exchange and you live and die by what you make, because it's nobody, you don't have a real job. You're, you know, whatever you make, you keep, and whatever you lose, you lose. And so for 20 years, I was a survivor, and I taught myself how to basically, you know, eat what I kill. But for 20 years, I stood in one spot and did the same thing every day and tried to, you know, make money. After a while, it gets, you know, you get good at it, but you also wonder if there's more to life. And as soon as the exchanges started to go fully electronic, I thought it was time to branch out and do other things. So that's why we started Thinkorswim.
Okay. So, and you started in 1999.
1999, the summer of 1999.
Before the dot-com crash. How was that?
Right before the dot-com crash. Yes.
Yeah. And then 2009, you sold it to TD Ameritrade.
Well, we were a public company, so we were publicly traded, and there were three companies trying to buy us, and we chose TD Ameritrade of the three companies, yes.
Okay, and then you sold it, and you start another trading platform, so...
I sold it, but then I started tastytrade, which was, with the goal was to change financial media. We didn't start another trading platform until 2017, tastyworks.
All right, so the greatest platform in the world.
Yes.
All right. So, well, thank you for being here, Tom, telling a little bit of your background. So we are going to start a little bit with some questions about the market outlook. What do you think the S&P 500 on all-time highs? So what do you see in the upcoming months?
Okay. So, and of course, you know, you understand these are very, very subjective, but I am very opinionated, so I have no problem. I think we are getting, anytime we get to all-time highs, one of the things I'd like to say is that I feel like there is a stronger, there's a lot more complacency around, and I feel like there's greater pot odds to the downside, meaning that if you look at velocity of risk where we are today, I'm much more scared about the downside than a continuation to the upside. I see the market in 2020, this was one of the most disastrous years in the history of the world. But the market just completely shrugged it off and went to all-time highs. I think you saw the market ride an incredible wall of worry. In 2021, I would be surprised to see a continuation. And I think the market, you know, I think the market is in a, it's going to have a very difficult time in 2021. I do see red flags. I see red flags in the sense that volatility is low right now on a relative basis. I see red flags in that we have an amazingly high level of optimism and an amazingly high level of complacency here. So I feel like those are all red flags as to being in an overbought scenario right now.
Okay. What options or strategy will you use for what we're expecting right now?
I won't change what I trade and how I trade, regardless of the, see, I'm a strategist. So I don't change the approach that we take. I mean, I like to sell premium. I will maintain short deltas. I do not necessarily change strategies. I'll use a variety of a diverse group of strategies. I will use not just a diverse group of strategies, but also a very large group of underlyings, because I'm indifferent to product. So I don't care if I'm trading stocks, futures options, indexes, ETFs, I don't care what, we'll trade anything.
Okay. Talking about, do you like to sell premium? So you don't like this type of strategy, like buying calls and buying puts?
I do not.
All right. Why is that?
Because it is a very low there is a low probability of success. So there's nothing wrong with buying calls or buying puts, but I like to be successful more than I like to fail. And so the difference with selling calls and selling puts is that you're statistically going to be right more than you're going to be wrong. Now, it doesn't mean you're going to make more money. You can make more money potentially buying calls and buying puts,
right,
but you're not going to be right nearly as many times as you sell it. So I prefer the probability of profit to be in my favor. So I am a much more aggressive option seller than buyer.
Right. And that's, I'm worried about it because you can find on the internet lots of things about, I'm going to tell you how to trade options, but every single one of them is telling them to play the lottery with options. And I refrain from that.
I am not a lottery player. I do not buy cheap options. I do not try to spend a dollar to make $10. I try to spend $5 to make $3.
That's a really good insight. That's a really good insight because most of the people that come to me, because they don't find any good content in Spanish. Actually, there is no content in Spanish about options. That's why I started the channel. It's following you guys, Tony Batista, yourself, Mike Butler, other guy from Option Alpha.
Sure, we do. We're an option think tank. We do an amazing amount of research.
Right. So I follow you guys. I am trying to put whatever I learn from you guys in the Spanish speaking word. So that's what I'm trying to do. And I'm so worried because so many people come to me just and they want to play the lottery with the market, just buying puts and buying calls. And I wanted to hear from the best, from someone I consider the best in this world. Thank you.
Well, the way most people play life is that way. I mean, you know, people like the idea of, you know, of low risk, high reward, but they don't understand that probabilistically you get very frustrated with that very fast. And I don't like to get frustrated with stuff. I like stuff where we have a much higher probability of profit because I want to be successful more than I want to fail.
Right. Very good insight. Thank you very much, Tom. Now, couple strategies. Call David spread versus put credit spread. Which one do you prefer? That, why? Tell us a little bit about it. Expiration dates, deltas.
So IV. It depends on the implied volatility rank. Theoretically speaking, now just talking about purely theoretically, these are the call debit spread or the put credit spread are theoretically, you know, very similar. They're virtually the same if you use the same strikes. So what we do is depending on IV rank, we will, if the IV rank is high, we will sell a put credit spread that's out of the money for a high probability of profit. If the IV rank is low, we will buy a call debit spread at the money, buy one strike in the money, sell one strike out of the money. And so we do it based on, we choose which one of these two we're going to do based on the implied volatility rank, which is a measure of where you put implied volatility ranked against itself. So that's what we do. We do call debit spreads when IV rank is low and put credit spreads when IV rank is high.
So, and do you use just a $1 wide or what is your preference about it?
No, $1 is too narrow. So what you want to do is to be a little bit wider. Now that depends on how much capital you want to use and things like that. But the wider you can go, the better off you are. So what you'd ultimately like to do is, if you're selling a put credit spread, you want to try to collect about 30 or 35% of the width of the strikes. And you want to keep the strikes a couple of strikes, you know, at least one or two strikes wide. And on a call debit spread, you want to buy one strike in the money, sell one strike out of the money, and try to do that for about one half the width of the strikes.
And what about expiration dates? How far you go?
45 days out is ideal. That's optimal.
Okay. When do you close the?
You close the close or roll. Our research shows, and we've done an incredible amount of research on this, you want to close or roll at about 21 days to expiration.
21 days to expiration, whether it's winning or not.
Yeah, like close, you would close a winner, you'd roll a loser or a scratch.
All right, thank you very much. Couple more. Butterflies versus broken wing butterfly.
Yeah.
Do you trade them?
Sure, I trade both of these. I did a broken wing butterfly today. My personal preference is the broken wing butterfly, because the broken wing butterfly is what we call a high probability strategy, and the long butterfly is a low probability strategy. So what we want to do is create scenarios where you have a high probability strategy. And the reason the broken wing butterfly is high probability is because you're selling a cheap out of the money call spread to finance the butterfly and do it for a net credit. So a long butterfly, you're paying a net debit for it. You're paying for it. So it has a low probability of profit because you've got to land right in that little triangle. The broken wing butterfly has a high probability of profit because you're doing it for a credit and you're selling an out of the money credit spread to finance the butterfly. So I like a broken wing butterfly better.
Okay. How's your Spanish doing?
How's the what?
Your Spanish?
Not good.
Not good? All right. All right. What about item condors? It's one of my favorite strategies overall. But what about you? What do you think about that?
I like iron condors. I did a couple of them today. Iron condors are simply two credit spreads, and it's the same criteria applies. High implied volatility rank. High implied volatility rank, you want to do, in a perfect world, you want to choose about the 20 or 25 delta strike, but you'd like to collect about 30 to 40% of the width of the combined strikes. You want to set this up so it has about a 60 to 70% probability of profit. You want to manage it 21 days, the same thing as all the other trades. And it's the kind of trade where it's low, you know, it's low risk, low reward. We put it that way.
Okay. So you said you use 70, 75% probability of profit?
It depends. You can set an iron condor up for it however you'd like. 50 is too low for me, so I prefer it to be somewhere between 60 and 70%.
Okay. And what about the iron fly? Do you play with them?
We do play with iron flies, not as much. Iron flies are usually a defensive play for us. So we start off with an iron condor and we roll the iron condor up into the iron fly.
Okay. Thank you. Very good insights. It's awesome. This is the one I probably like the most, the poor man's covered call. Do you like this one?
Yes, I do.
All right.
Poor man's covered call is an interesting strategy. It is, you buy a long-term option and you sell a near-term option against it. It's the reason it's called a poor man's covered call is because most people buy stock and they sell a call against it. But the reason we call this a poor man's covered call is because we buy an option longer term and then sell a front month call against it. It has a high probability of profit. It also likes high implied volatility, but it has a high probability of profit. And it is a very simple trade to execute, a very simple trade to roll. You can keep it on for some time, and it gives you the long bias or long deltas that you might like.
Okay. So, do you have any deltas in preferences for the long one?
The delta preference for the option you buy should be around 50, and the delta preference for the option you sell should be around 35.
Okay. I'm doing it with the 80 delta, actually. Yeah. For the long one, and the 30, 35 for the short one. Yeah.
Beautiful.
Okay.
That's okay. Listen, the depending on the user, you can go as deep as you want delta wise, because if you want to be bullish, you use a bigger delta.
Right. That's correct. All right. Some questions. We have so many questions. We have 424 people connected right now on YouTube. This is live on YouTube.
Awesome, man. Thank you so much. Where are most people located?
Everywhere in the world. Everywhere in every single Spanish-speaking country. They are in Mexico, here in U.S., Colombia, Venezuela, Ecuador, Spain, in Europe. We have people from around the world, actually.
Beautiful. Bring them on. Every Spanish-speaking person in the world, bring them on.
Of course. And you know what? I made a video like a couple months ago and I ranked my top platform. It's not because you're here, but I don't even have a Tastyworks account, but I rank it on the very, very top one. It's the first one. Is the one I love the most. And the only reason I don't have a Tastyworks account, even apply for them, because I'm under work permit. When that's a long story. So the type of visa that you guys require to open an account is not listed in my visa. So I had to open it as a foreign customer, so I'm working on it. But I definitely love your platform. I recommend your platform to every single person I know. It's the best platform I ever
done. Beautiful, beautiful. We love that. Thank you.
Yeah, we have some questions.
Fire away.
All right. So this is from Maria Sheikh from Bogota, Colombia. What is your favorite strategy in the options world, and what do you recommend for this select group of students? ¿Cuál es su estrategia favorita en el mundo de las opciones y qué nos recomienda para este selecto grupo de estudiantes?
Well, my favorite strategy, Luis, is, or Maria, is my favorite strategy is a short strangle. Now, you're not going to hear that a lot in the world of most, you know, people that are interested in options and derivatives and futures and things like that. But I think the strategy that offers the most reward for the highest probability of profit is what's most intriguing to me. So I like a short strangle, which is the simultaneous sale of a call and a put with very little associated delta when you first put it on. It's easy to adjust. It has the type of position where basically what you're hoping for is that volatility contracts and time goes by. It's the classic just don't get hit by a bus strategy. So yes, I like that's my favorite strategy. If I had to pick one, that would be it.
Okay, so this you will use it in high implied volatility environments.
Yes, because in a high implied volatility environment, you have two factors working for you. Not only do you have time in your favor, but you also have volatility contraction.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much. I have another question. This time it's from Ecuador. It's Jose Romero. And what strategy would you recommend to protect a portfolio? ¿Qué estrategia recomiendas para proteger el portafolio?
So Jose, I would recommend in this case, in most cases. Now, remember, you can't truly protect a portfolio. What you can do is you can mitigate some of the risk. And so what I would do against a portfolio is either sell an out of the money index call or an out of the money index call spread. What you're doing is you're focusing on the amount of theoretical notional premium that you're selling against the position. So let me give you an example. Let's say you have, for example, a $30,000, I'm converting to US dollars, but let's say you have a $25,000 or $30,000 portfolio, okay? And let's say that you decided that you wanted to hedge a $30,000 portfolio. If you sold one out of the money call in the spiders or one wide out of the money call spread in the spiders, that would theoretically hedge either all 30,000 or a portion of the 30,000, depending on what the delta is. So if the delta was 50, it would hedge, you know, the equivalent of 18,000. If the delta of the spread was 20, it would hedge the equivalent of, you know, 7,600 or whatever it is. But that's the kind of position, an out of the money call or an out of the money call spread in an index to hedge an overall portfolio of a diversified portfolio of stocks.
Okay. There is a question from the chat. I'm just speaking a random one. It says, can Tom tell us how do you build a good portfolio? How have to be conformed? How do you build a portfolio?
So to build a good portfolio is not easy. And there's no such thing as like a textbook way of building a good portfolio. But what I will tell you is there's a couple things you want to do. The first thing is you want to be product indifferent. So you have to be, it doesn't matter what specific product you pick. You want to pick multiple products that are not highly correlated. Like you don't want to pick gold, silver, and copper because they're all highly correlated. But you might want to pick gold and then a technology stock and then in like a crude oil stock or a currency or something like that, or an industrial or manufacturing stock. So you have some diversification of product. Then you want to diversify strategy, which is really important. So first you diversify product, then you diversify strategy. Those are the two most important things right out of the chute.
All right. Pedro is asking me, how do you play in the earnings season?
So I play the earnings season very aggressively. I I feel like the earnings, I feel like earnings are what we call, they're called binary events. And the earnings, we play them with using short-term options, and we play them outside of the expected move. So if you use the Tastyworks platform, you'll see what the expected move is based on implied volatility for any earnings play. And so let's say the expected move is plus or minus $7 for the next day or the day after that. We'll play it out about between $10 and $14. So we'll play between 1.5 and 2 times the expected move on the outside of that. And then we'll set our earnings plays up short term at 1.5 or 2 times the expected move.
Okay, I have a couple questions from Mexico. And this one is from Juan Zaragoza. And let's imagine you're single, Tom. If you could choose one single strategy, just one, what will it be? What option strategy would you get married with?
I would get married with the strangle.
The strangle, okay.
Yep.
The short one.
Yeah, short strangle. Short a call, short a put, 16 to 20 deltas in that range.
45 days?
45 days.
45 days, right. I'm going to tell in Spanish. Imaginemos que Tom es soltero. Si pudieras elegir una sola estrategia, ¿cuál sería? Y esa sería el short strangle. Thank you very much, Sean. Tom. And I have another question for you. What is your favorite stock to play with?
Oh, well, there's a difference between most successful stock and favorite stock. I mean, right now, I think the most interesting stock on the board is probably Tesla, because it has the most, it has the deepest liquidity, and it has the most stuff going on. You know, like as far as it has the highest volatility, it has the most amount of risk, it has the highest premium. So I think Tesla would probably be the my favorite stock right now.
Right now, and which one do you play more regularly on a regular basis? Is it the spiders or stocks or indexes?
If you're talking about indexes, I probably play the NASDAQ and the ES the most. If you're talking about stocks, I probably play like Tesla, Apple, Zoom the most, those kind of stocks.
Okay. Regular stocks or futures market?
I do both. I trade futures options and I trade futures options and listed options.
And which one you prefer?
80% of what I trade is listed options. 20% are futures and futures options.
Okay, perfect. That's my question. I have another question from Maria Giliberti. She's from Venezuela. And is what is your daily routine when it comes to select a play? ¿Cuál es tu rutina diaria para seleccionar una jugada en específico?
Yeah, that's fair, Maria. So my daily routine is, you know, and I'm a little bit crazy about this. So I'm an early riser. So at 4 a.m, I get up and I look at the markets. I answer some emails and I start planning out my day based on what happened overnight. But I don't really get into a lot of stuff. I only adjust positions early on, you know, pre-market. I wait till the market opens. And then in the course of the morning, and I also, if you, I don't know if we take accounts, Maria, from Venezuela, but I also on the platform show everything that I do every day. Like today I made 108 trades. So I trade a lot. And so most days I average between 90 and 120 trades. So I'm all over the place. So I don't have a specific daily routine. It depends on the amount of activity, but usually I'd like, you know, to kind of early in the morning, decide how I'm thinking. And then from that point on, you know, adjust positions and open new trades.
How big are your positions? What is the size of your positions?
Say that one more time.
How big are your positions you open every day?
I try to keep them. I try to use the Tasty Trade philosophy of trade small, trade often. So I keep my positions relatively small, and I try to trade a lot. I find we use law of large numbers. It's just a basic math equation, but I find that to be the most effective tool.
Right. Your philosophy is my philosophy, Tom. I play with small positions as well. All right. I have another question. This one is from Christian Constantin from Bogota, Colombia. And how would you allocate a $10,000 portfolio? Strategies, underlying assets. Si tuvieras solamente $10,000, ¿cómo distribuirías el portafolio? ¿Con estrategias? ¿Con qué tipo de estrategias y activos?
So, Christian, here's what I would do with a $10,000 portfolio. I would And we've created lots of sample portfolios so you can see a lot of the stuff. I think your focus should be on, again, you want to stay very small. You don't want to allocate much more than $500 to $1,000 per trade. And you should have at least 10 trades in a $10,000 portfolio, 10 different underlines. So strategies, you want to be about 50% defined risk and about 50% undefined risk. And you should have about 10 underlines on. And you've got to mix up those underlines and you've got to mix up those strategies. Like I said, about 10 positions, 5 undefined risk, 5 defined risk, between $500 and $1,000 per trade, and don't use more than 65 to 75% of the capital total.
There is a really nice question from Claudio. He's from Chile. He says, how does Mr. Tom maintain a sustainable mental attitude? Thank you.
Because I'm a junkie. I do this every day.
From 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. and now you're alive with us. So
I do this every day. Who asked that question? Who was that?
It's Claudio from Chile.
Claudia, you know what? It takes a lot of, you have to love what you do and you have to be passionate about it. I love the business that we're in and I'm very passionate about the trading business. And so, you know what? I've been addicted to the markets for a long time and I'm still here.
And Pedro has a question. Tom, do you use 0 days to expiration?
Only on binary events like earnings or maybe an expiration, but not very often.
All right. I have another question. How Tasty Works will help the Spanish-speaking community? When will you guys add additional countries to the list, such as Ecuador, Venezuela, Bolivia, and Salvador?
We're trying. It's hard for us because there's a lot of anti-money laundering rules in the U.S. with the clearing firms, and we have trouble accepting accounts from countries that are listed. And listen, it's not us. It's our clearing firms. It's our banks that don't want to do money transfers with certain countries. And I don't get it myself. It drives me out of my mind. My goal is to go global next year. I think every country should be allowed to do business with us. I hate it when we can't take business, you know, from different places, because there's so many people in different countries I'd love to be able to service. A lot of them are, you know, South American, some are in Eastern Europe, and it drives me crazy. So yeah, I'm with you on that. I want to be able to take customers from anywhere.
Yeah, you know, because people ask me all the time, hey, what broker do you recommend? The first question I ask, where are you located? And say, okay, depending on your location, I will recommend a broker. But let me tell you, the broker that works for most people are very expensive brokers. Very, very expensive brokers.
Well, the thing is that we have better technology than anybody else. Our technology is faster, more stable than any other firm. So like, you know, I don't think there's a better broker than us. The problem is it's hard for US brokers to deal with all the regulatory requirements of, you know, of certain countries and certain banking systems. And I think once we're able to move money using digital currency, everything will get a lot easier.
Talking about digital currency, what do you think? What are your thoughts about it? Because a lot of people are getting into the Bitcoin rush again. I don't know. I just don't like it. It's my personal opinion. What is your opinion about it?
I think it's an overcrowded space right now. It's a little bit too rich. And I think you got to be really careful. I mean, we're Bitcoin close today at $21,350. Bitcoin is a little too expensive for my blood up here. But I do think that digital assets and digital money transfers, especially from places in South America, are going to eventually open the doors to accessing US financial firms so you guys can trade US markets.
All right. This is a non-related question, but I think it's fair to ask. Miguel Rivas from Mexico, what is your favorite book and movie that you recommend?
Favorite book and movie? You mean financial?
he doesn't say.
Well, let's talk financial books. Right. So, because there's not a lot of great financial books. I think the best one is When Genius Fails. It's the story of long-term capital management and when they failed in, you know, in 1999 because they thought they were geniuses and they weren't. But I think When Genius Fails is great. And I mean, my favorite trading movie obviously is Trading Places. you know, that's the best, that's the best one ever made. But you know, if I had to, I also love, just because it's a crazy movie, I love Wolf of Wall Street.
Oh, I love it too. Ricky, he's from, I believe he's from Mexico, Ricardo. If you have to do a roll forward on a cover call strategy and you're collecting premium every week, what day of the week is well, I guess he's trying to say which one is better.
Well, to do what you'd want to do, Ricky, is you want to roll that position on a consistent basis. It's not, it doesn't matter what day of the week you choose. It matters that you're consistent about when you roll. Because the only way you can, the only way you can really keep the kind of the mechanics alive is to be consistent about it. The key is, I feel like the key is what delta you choose, and I think you should choose around the 30 delta. But with respect to what day, you want to be consistent. And I think if you roll, my preference is to roll early in the week. Some people like to roll late in the week. I think early in the week gives you more flexibility and less risk.
Pedro is, I know, telling something non-related. Tom, I loved your hair. And you know what, Tom? You should give me the formula because I'm getting so bald right now. All right.
Yeah, well, I don't cut my hair anymore. I just let it grow. What the hell?
Okay, there is another question from Maria Isabel. Tom, thank you. I have a couple questions for you. How do you interpret the, I guess she's talking about the unusual volume options activity. How you can, well, what that information, that measure, what is telling you? What is telling you about the market?
Yeah, it's not telling me anything. Unusual option activity can be very misleading, and I would strongly recommend not leaning on unusual option activity as a indicator or as a direction on what you're going to trade. All be right. Very careful about using unusual option activity.
Thank you. Carlos Jones from Medellin, Colombia says, Luis, you should ask Tom if we open an account, could we get like the beanie you use?
Of course.
So we can get the beanie. Actually, I'm gonna buy one.
Just send me an email, I'll send you one.
Thank you. All right. What do you think about the stocks, stock sector? Energy, technology, banks? Could you give us some insights?
I like, Of all those sectors, I think the one that's probably the least expensive is probably the energy sector. Second least expensive would be the financial sector. Technology, I think, is overbought. So I would stay away from the technology sector. I don't mind the energy sector.
Okay. Do you like it? Because I don't know. I feel that the energy sector is going down the hill for the last 5 years.
Here's the thing. I don't love the energy sector at all. But if you're comparing it to the technology sector, I think it's a lot less expensive.
All right. I have a couple of questions. Okay, we covered that already from the earnings season. There is another question from Cuba. Mailer Porro from Cuba. Now, is there a book you recommend for options?
There are a lot of reference guides, but no book that I recommend for options. Now, and I'm sorry about that because I don't, there are reference guides that have been around for a long time, like Shelley Natenberg's book, Larry McMillan's book, but they're very, very heavy reference guides. They're complete and they have a lot of information in them, but I don't think there's a really good, like, you know, option book. There's a million of them, just so you know. So it's not like there aren't any. There's a million of them, and some of them are okay. None of them blow me away. Let's put it that way.
All right. Difference between stock options and future options.
Stock options have smaller, they're smaller, and so they're easier to trade. They're more liquid. They're more competitive. They have less capital efficiency than futures options. So futures options are more capital efficient. They're much bigger notional size. They have a little more advantageous hours, but the problem with options on futures is there's a very limited market. There's only about 7 or 8 that are liquid.
Right.
So if you want to trade options on futures, there's not a lot of choices. I think if you want to trade kind of all the cool equities, you have to trade, you know, index and equity options and ETFs.
Right. From Bogota, Colombia, When will become Tastyworks available in Spanish?
That's a good question from Bogota, Colombia. We tried when we first launched, we did Tasty Trade. We did one segment of Tasty Trade in Spanish. It's still up on our website, Tasty Trade in Espanol. And we used a woman that used to work for me on the trading floor, because she's from Ecuador. And so, if you email me later, I can send you a link, but they're a little older now, but she did a really good job, but we did not get enough traction with it to keep it going.
You know what? More and more people are like becoming more and more interested about trading, especially options. I will say options are very, very new to the Spanish community because there is no content. Honestly,
well,
Tom.
Well, the problem with options in South America is that none of the exchanges are mature enough at this point to offer that kind of liquidity in the option marketplace.
And they will never become, I'm telling you. So that's why people is coming to the U.S. market.
Yes, of course. We have the only pool of liquidity, right.
So that being said, there is a good opportunity in the Spanish-speaking market. Like 600 million people around the world.
I wish I had the ability to do everything, you know, I wish I could do more.
All right. Use me. If you need me, yes, use me, Tom. All right. What do you think about the new platforms like Robinhood and Webull?
What do I think about it?
Yeah, there is a question from
Humberto. I think they're okay. I mean, the problem with them is that they're good for introduction to the industry, but they're horrible for trading on. So you know, we have a saying, it's sometimes you can't afford free. And like our technology is so good and you can do so much more stuff and you can spread stuff off. You can trade any product. I mean, on their stuff, you're really limited and it's really basic. I mean, is it okay? Sure, it's okay. And am I glad they're around? Sure, I don't mind them. But they're not that interesting to me as a trader. They serve no value.
Is your portfolio 100% built on options?
100% built on options and futures, yes.
Yes, 100%. How do you build a retirement portfolio using only options?
Oh, I do it easy. That's all I've ever been doing. I mean, that's been my whole life.
Yeah, but I mean,
you don't have to do that, but I just do it.
I'm doing it too. But what strategies will you put in place for a retirement portfolio?
Well, I probably use, you know, between 6 and 8 different strategies, and I'm fairly aggressive. You know, and occasionally I'll use underlying futures, and every once in a while I'll buy or sell stock, but I don't have that much stock.
All right. There is another question. Tom, if you're starting from zero in this business, if you didn't know anything about trading, where would you start? Where do you recommend a brand new person?
I would go to Tasty Trade, and I'm telling you this, just I don't care, because we have an unbelievable learn center, and it's free. I wouldn't spend any money, do anything. We have an unbelievable learn center on Tasty Trade, and you could just go to the site and go to our learn center, and it's not in Spanish, but you can spend days on that learn center and learn more than you can learn anywhere else. No, it's beautifully done.
I personally learned from Tasty Trade a lot. I'm telling you, a lot. So since there is no book that you don't recommend, would you write one?
Ah, you'll have to wait this year. You'll see.
So you're working on it.
I can't tell you for sure. I heard a rumor.
You heard a rumor. Okay, I heard it too. Okay, the Ambrosio. Tom, I got a question. What do you think about the electric vehicle company Tesla Neo versus the oil, ones, General Motors, Ford?
So I drive a Tesla. So I'm very familiar with the, you know, that's my primary car. But I think the stocks are all overpriced.
You mean the electric vehicle ones?
Yeah, the electric vehicles.
And what about the traditional in the car industry?
Well, the traditional car industry in the U.S., we really only have, you know, Ford and General Motors, and they're both those are tough stocks to trade.
Right. So there is a question from Luis Garcia. What do you try to accomplish on the user interface with Tastyworks? What do you think is better than the other platforms?
Do I think it's better than what?
Than the other platforms around.
Well, the second best platform is Thinkorswim, and we built that one too. So that was my first company, and I built that 20 years ago. And so it's a little outdated now, and it's slow and it's outdated, but that was the best platform. Now Tastyworks is the best platform, and we built that one.
Why is better Tastyworks?
It's more stable, it's faster, and the technology is a vision of the content that we produce today.
Opinion about Chinese companies?
I mean, I personally like trading Chinese companies like JD and Alibaba and Baidu. So I don't have a problem with it at all. You know, I don't have an issue.
Okay. Let me see. There is one more question. Jose Miguel Tomas. Hey, Luis, one question for Tom. Is it possible that we can access the platform? Sorry, I'm translating. So he's trying to say, because I'm not very familiar with the Tastyworks platform. But
so he wants to access the platform without being able to open an account with us. And that's the hard part. No, you can't. You have to be from a place where you can ultimately open an account.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. That's the question. Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm sorry about that. That's a regulatory rule. And I'll explain why. The reason why they do that is because the local regulators don't want you soliciting business where you're not registered, where you can't take money.
So what do you think? This is Carlos Jones again from Medellin. What do you think about the platforms that are using like these automatic processes, like the new one that Option Alpha released along with, what is the name? TradeStation, I guess?
Oh, you're talking about like a trading bot?
Yeah.
I'm indifferent to it. I don't care one way or the other. I mean, I personally believe brains over bots. So I like the idea that people are trying to automate certain mechanics, but the bottom line is you have to understand what you're doing in order to automate anything. Okay. You can't automate success. You cannot automate success. In it, you can automate, here, let me rephrase that, Lewis. You cannot automate success in a efficient market. You can automate success in an inefficient market. Because if a market is inefficient, you can take advantage of those inefficiencies and you can arb them out. In an efficient market, you cannot automate success. And we live in an efficient market.
That's right, we live in an efficient market. There is a very good question people are asking me about this. What strategy do you use in March when the market went down the hill?
Not a good one.
Which one?
It was difficult for all of us, regardless of strategy. I tried to use the same strategies I'm using today. They just didn't work very well.
Okay.
Because remember, March was a once in a decade type thing.
Okay. There is a question from Jorge Luis Matute. Tastyworks, can he make it more mobile friendly? I guess he.
Oh, yes, we are. There's going to be, just so you know, a brand new iPad app coming out in February and a brand new Android app coming out in March or April.
Okay. Johan Lavoise, I just opened a new Tastyworks account and I got 100 free shares. Great. I didn't know you were giving away.
Yes, we do. We give you 100 free shares.
Oh, great. All right. So there is another, do you have like a paper money account?
No, we do not. Not with Tastyworks. We decided not to build it so that we could focus on real streaming content.
Okay. And I know that you have two platforms, DAW and Tastyworks. Why do you have two of them?
Well, we built DAW to compete with like Robinhood and places like that so that we could have an introduction, you know, to our technology. So DAW is a free platform that competes with like Webull and Robinhood.
Okay. There is another question from CACC62. Well, hi, Luis. My question is, what type of factors influence in the value of option contract? Well, we have talked about it, but I will hear from the best. Do you care about, let's say, Greeks? Do you care about open interest? Do you care about volume?
I care about volume because I care about liquidity. So I care about volume and I do care about Greeks, but I don't care about them all. I primarily focus on delta because I want to know my directional risk, and theta because I want to know how much premium I'm collecting.
Luis Monasterio says, how many hours do you work every day?
A lot. I've been going 40 years, 14, 15 hours a day.
All right. Is it possible to open an account in Tastyworks from Chile?
Yes.
All right. You see, Chile is open for business with Tastyworks.
Chile's open, Peru's open, Colombia, I'm not sure, I don't remember.
Yeah, Colombia's open, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, Colombia's open.
I'm from Colombia.
Ecuador's open, Brazil's open, so there, Argentina's open.
Same thing for Dell?
Yeah, same thing.
Same thing for Dell. All right, so what is Luis Sepulveda says, Tom, what are the most common errors at the moment of generate strategies? I don't know.
The most common error is that people, they trade too big. The most common error is people trade too big.
All right. Well, Tom, do you prefer a strangle more than a jade lizard?
Yes. Yes, I prefer the strangle over jade lizard.
Right. All right. Tom, seriously, it's such a great honor being with you here today. It's great. I feel so honored that you put aside some time.
I'm honored that you asked me, and I will, I love speaking to your audience because I'm upset that we can't get to everybody that we want to. So if you ever want to have me back on, you just give me a holler.
Absolutely, absolutely. So any words for these Spanish speaking communities about, I don't know, the market overall in 2021? Why should we go with Tastyworks?
Everybody's smart. So I'm not gonna say that. But what I will say is my email is tom@tastytrade.com. And if you want to reach out, if you have any questions, please feel free. I will answer them myself. I'm just tom@tastytrade.com, and we'd love to hear from you. We're also, just so you know, we're doing a World Rising Star show in January. So if anybody out there is using Tasty and they think that they're a rising star, we'd love to have you, drop me an email, tom@tastytrade, and we'll see if we can sneak you on our rising star show. We might be already booked up, but I don't know.
All right, thank you very much for letting me know. Again, thank you very much, Tom. I will write you an email. I will invite you in the future. And thanks for your time.
Beautiful. Thanks so much. Goodbye, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. So, si quieren abrir una cuenta con Tastyworks, ya saben, van a www.tastyworks.com y allí van a poder abrir una cuenta con este maravilloso trade producto, esta maravillosa plataforma. Espero que hayan disfrutado. Voy a editar el video, lo voy a poner en español para que ustedes tomen esos insights, esas recomendaciones por parte de Tom Sosnoff, una leyenda de Wall Street, ya se los había dicho en muchas ocasiones, han sido mi mentor, mi maestro. Y bueno, ya saben, tienen alguna idea, alguna noción de cómo un tipo que empezó desde que aparecieron las opciones en el mercado, 20 años siendo market maker de opciones, tiene su portafolio construido 100% en opciones, su portafolio de retiro construido 100% en opciones. Así que sí se puede, sí se puede. Así que mis estimados amigos, compañeros, panas, socios, patas, parceros, güeyes, tíos, maes, aleros y todo lo que me hagan falta, boricuas, nanitos, espero que lo hayan disfrutado tanto como yo. Como les digo, voy a poner los subtítulos en inglés, discúlpenme, en español, así que espero que de aquí al día viernes ya tenerlo subido en el canal y puedan darle un repaso, porque nos dio información muy clave, nos dio información supremamente clave de todo lo que, de las estrategias que estamos usando realmente, las que yo recomiendo a través del canal Opción Sigma, y mirar, por ejemplo, algo que yo recomiendo es abrir una estrategia de Poor Man's Cover Call con el strike de .80. Él está recomendándolo abrir por .50. Tengo que cruzarme un par de emails más con él, pero definitivamente cuando nos bajamos a .50, pues vamos a hacer una reducción del delta tremendo, por lo tanto esa estrategia va a ser muchísimo más eficiente en el uso del capital. Así que, de verdad, todos los días aprendemos algo nuevo. Yo estoy aquí encantado porque yo recibí una clase magistral del que es, yo creo que está en el top en el mundo del tema de las opciones, y miren que Bueno, no estamos errados. Podemos hacer aquí algunos ajusticos que para hacer más eficientes nuestras estrategias, para hacerlas más rentables, especialmente esa me dejó pensando mucho, la del Poor Man's Cover Call. Y hay alguna que no utilizo, son los Short Strangles, pero bueno, vamos a hacer algunas, a practicar un poco más, hacer un poco de copy trading a lo que él está haciendo con los Short Strangles. Y ahí vamos a sacar cosas muy interesantes. Como les digo, muy afortunado de tenerlo a él hoy aquí en el show, en tenerlo aquí en Opción Sigma, el canal. Si son nuevos por acá, les pido, suscríbanse al canal. Vamos a traer más de estos personajes que definitivamente nos van a ayudar en el camino, para que sigamos construyendo lo que yo digo, la tranquilidad financiera. No la libertad financiera, porque ese término ha estado tan usado y tan mal usado en no sé, por las multinivel, por pirámides, por etcétera, que a mí me preocupa mucho utilizar ese término, y por eso quiero alejarme de él. Pero sí, la tranquilidad financiera es cómo podemos construir un proceso de acumulación de riqueza a través de este mundo tan maravilloso, el mundo de las opciones. Y fíjense, 100%, transando 100% opciones. No transa otra cosa, sino opciones. Excelentes tips. Muchas gracias a todos los que se unieron hoy. Muy gracias por el apoyo. A dos personas no les gustó el contenido. Bueno, supongo que habrá algo que retroalimentar. Pero bueno, espero que a la mayoría, 388 personas, sí les gustó el contenido. Tenemos 428 personas conectadas en este momento, 428 personas conectadas. Y a los que le faltaron un like sería infinitamente apreciado. Esperen la versión en español. El viernes, Dios mediante, vamos a tener ya la versión en español montada aquí en el canal. Así que pendientes, si no se han suscrito, ya saben lo que tienen que hacer, suscribirse. Y espero tenerlas disponibles para que ustedes las repasen y vean esos tips que nos dio, esa retroalimentación que nos dio, esos takeaways que nos dio para que seamos mucho más exitosos en nuestro trading día a día. Así que un saludo muy especial para todos. Espero que lo hayan disfrutado tanto como yo, que haya sido una gran experiencia. Y happy trading. No sé si hay algunas preguntas. No lo voy a borrar. Lo voy a dejar ahí y voy a subir otra versión en el canal. Así que no, voy a dejarlo ahí. Esto está aquí para la posteridad. Ya llegamos hoy, ya estamos llegando casi a los 18 mil seguidores y llegamos casi, o ya estamos en 50 mil seguidores en TikTok. 50 mil seguidores a través de la plataforma de TikTok. Muchas gracias a todos los que han creído en este proyecto. Muchas gracias por toda la paciencia. Muchas gracias por los días buenos, pero más gracias por los días malos que hemos tenido. Y aquí seguimos firmes sacando este proyecto adelante y ayudándoles a ustedes con todos sus sueños, a que esos sueños que ustedes tienen se hagan realidad. Un saludo muy especial para todos. Nos vemos en la próxima. Cuídense mucho. Un abrazo. No olviden darle like, suscribirse y apoyar el canal, para que podamos seguir trayendo personajes como este, que nos den clases así, en vivo, que ustedes le puedan preguntar a los que saben de esto. Un saludo muy especial. Cuídense mucho y nos vemos en la próxima. Hasta pronto. No sean vagos. Estudien. Chao, chao.